When your administration came into power in 2008, the priority was cost of living.
Yes.
What can you tell Barbadians? What your government can show that justifies their faith in your government on that mantra of cost?
We had an unprecedented, unmatched, and even unrealistic spike in commodity prices. Wheat and grain prices and corn prices have just skyrocketed. I mean, and almost every application that we have in the world is constituted of corn or wheat or some type of grain. We've also had an unrelenting march in oil prices, which filters through to everything we produce as it relates to the consumption of energy. In the context of that, I think Barbadians are not unreasonable. They know that we have tried our best, but are fighting a much bigger dilemma than we would have expected in the circumstances. And I mean, when you really look at it, it is amazing that we've been able to keep inflation going at 7%. The inflation rate under the last government in 2002, 2004, 2005 went to 9%. This is when times were good, when oil prices were reasonably low, and when commodity prices were not out of whack. So therefore, when you say one thing, you have to say another. What we've tried to do is to introduce some measures that will cause us to look for additional markets, to do better sourcing. We've also gone in where necessary, for example, and adjusted some tariff rates in the trading system of Barbados. And particularly, for example, in 2008-09, when grain prices peaked to such unreasonably high levels, the government of Barbados subsidized the operations of basically the flour company, so that, and the grain company, so that that pass-through would not have the full effect on the people of Barbados in relation to food prices. We've constantly said that there must be a structured overall examination of pricing structures in Barbados. What happens to the pass-through in relation to where goods are sourced, the price at which they are sourced, the taxes which have gone on to them, and as the former Minister of Foreign Trade, I know that we do have a copious levels of import duties that are applied to many products for protection purposes, but there are quite a few who frankly are not protecting anything and need to be revised in the environment in which we can do so safely without imploding our revenues, to ensure that the pass through to the public is a reasonable price. But I believe that all of us have had to take a dose of very hard reality in relation to these matters, and it is going to be very difficult for me or any other minister or member of the opposition to say that they have a magic formula that can solve the issue of prices in this environment. If the environment had remained ostensibly what it was in 2006-07, then all options were on the table. But in this hard, core, protracted economic downturn in the business cycle, globally, and the impact which it is having going forward, it is going to be extremely difficult for any of us to say that we can bring and make major reductions in food prices.
What happened to the basket of goods that was supposed to be expanded? What's the latest on that?
We are still examining the basket of goods. There are issues related to that. There are some goods in the basket that frankly need to be taken out, and there are others that need to be put in. We at the Ministry of Finance, working with the Ministry of Trade and Commerce, or Commerce and Trade, I think it is called, want to ensure that very shortly we are able to say something positive to the public of Barbados in relation to this. But we have to be very clear. Now, I have seen some recommendations from non-governmental and governmental agencies for things in the basket of goods, which I frankly do not think should be in there. Salad dressing, or French salad dressing, and hot dogs, and hamburgers, and those kinds of unhealthy foods. I think that there are more healthy and judicious choices from locally produced foods that can find their way into that basket, and even from those which are imported. So I believe that together with Senator Ben, who's been very, very persistent in this matter and vigilant in relation to prices across the establishments in Barbados that retail and wholesale, that we can come up with a formula that will work for people in Barbados, including for those persons who have special issues such as diabetes, hypertension, and other non-communicable
diseases. Mr. Minister, before you go, the earlier question from Mr. Hoyos, how we are going to finance the new hospital, I don't think you answered. Could you?
Oh, the hospital, yes. But I'm sorry about that, because there were few questions in the question itself. Funding of the new hospital. Well, we now have to put together the financing package for the hospital. Look, the minister announced the intention and the desire of government to have a new hospital constructed. But as you would imagine, it is going to take between 3 to 5 years, perhaps even more, to actually begin to break ground on such a facility, because you have to go in and do, now it's a greenfield site, so you have to go in and do all of the work in relation to feasibilities, assessments, environmental impact assessments. You have to look at the entire medical assessments as well. What is required? What are you going to do? Are they going to be specialized services? Are you going to have one monolithic structure, or are you going to separate the various functions in the hospital in terms of cardiac, pediatrics, emergency, spread over fields? You have to find the most appropriate location. And we, together with the Ministry of Health, will be working assiduously to put together a financing package that is affordable to the government and that we can handle going forward. So when the minister, I think the minister did say that you're not going to have a turnkey operation overnight, I think that is specifically what the minister was referring to, and that it will take time. But the feasibility work, because it takes between 18 months to 2 years to get through all of those things, the cabinet said that now was the time to start that work, so that as soon as that work is finished, once we have the financing package together, and most likely that would have to be done with external sources on a PPP basis, then we can go ahead and start the actual construction. However, very shortly, I anticipate that the minister, in fact, I have only recently signed off on a facility for the Principal Hospital to get resources to do some upgrades to its existing system, because we still have to maintain that facility whilst we do work on the new hospital. And therefore, the $35 million, which will come to Parliament shortly, is to assist in ensuring that both electrical work and some of the system work at the QEH are kept up to an internationally accepted standard.
But one bugbear at it, as much water phrases, have been four seasons.
Yes.
I've recently been hearing about the allegations that government is beginning to do pockets of NIS to fund the project. Could you give us an update as to what is happening with this project, where is it going, and what is that?
I have actually never seen any proposal from the Four Seasons people to the NIS. I am not the minister responsible for the National Insurance Board. I am the minister responsible under the law as Minister of Finance for NIS investments. No such thing was notified to me. When I returned to the country, in the swirl of all of this talk about the government putting pressure on the NIS, and I must invest in Four Seasons, I must make this point. As Minister of Finance, I have never called the National Insurance Scheme, its board chairman, its investment manager, or anybody else at National Insurance to ask them to invest in any project. And I hope that that will now remain. When I was responsible for the NIS board, I don't usually harass my board chairman or getting to calling the CEOs of these institutions and giving them a lot of off-color political direction. That's not the way they've been taught me to do it. But what I do know is that we ask, for example, that if the NIS is going to make any strategic investment, that at least we be notified. So as Minister, if you ask me a question, I can respond to it. Now, I subsequently learned and saw the proposal, because in all of this circus atmosphere that was going around, I had a conversation with the Honorable Prime Minister, and we agreed that we would invite everybody to come to a meeting at Elarocourt to kind of hear what was going on, to see what the proposal was, and to hear what the response of NIS was. And that's what we did. It was really almost like a fact-finding mission. And we satisfied ourselves that in terms of the protocol, the process was being followed correctly. We neither gave instructions to them or invited them to make any decisions. And I have not yet done so. The NIS apparently has been approached by the Four Seasons people, as they are approached by many people for investments in matters. I read the investment report of the NIS, for example, and the NIS has made a strategic investment in the AXL project through a bond issue, I believe, by the Barbados National Bank. This is the project that CEO Williams company is still up into that. And I had no involvement in that. They've been approached, and they have been approached by many other institutions, to consider investing in the Four Seasons project. Now let's put some facts on the table. The Four Seasons project started as a private sector, purely private sector initiative, largely by persons who could be considered as foreign direct investors. It collapsed under the weight of a major financial and economic collapse globally, and was left there basically to fail. The late Prime Minister felt that given the 800 or so persons who had lost their jobs, and the more than 200 to 300 small businesses in Barbados, not Martians, you know, not Americans, not British people, not Vincentians or Dominicans, Barbadian companies, who have provided goods and services to this project, but who were holding IOUs from the Four Seasons people, that it would have been very difficult for them to continue their operations locally and or retain their staff if they were allowed not to be able to be restituting the monies which they were owed for services and goods which they supplied. So he invited Professor Avinash Prasad and the team to see if they could put together an arrangement to get the Four Seasons project going again. And you know what the history of that has been. The first iteration of the restructuring was to try to get the villa owners to continue to put their money in so that the project could get restarted, and that resources required to bring the hotel project on stream would be able to be sourced while that work was going on. Of course, the villa owners felt that given the high level of debt overhang, close to $120 million, that it was not possible for them to put their money in there because they were afraid their money might have been used to liquidate those debts owed to various persons in Barbados. And so the government of Barbados decided on the invitation of the company that we would back a guarantee for some capital to be provided by Anson Merchant Bank. And that was provided. Most of those creditors were paid off. I think there's still $30-35 million left to be paid to some people, but most of those were paid off. In the interim, the villa owners decided that they were not going to proceed because they wanted additional things to happen. They wanted all kinds of concessions to be provided, which were not reasonable. They were watching to say, I am waiting to see who is going to put in first before I put my money in. And in that kind of environment, it was decided, look, the best thing to do was to go to do the hotel, to seek the resources for the hotel, and then they could come later when they see the action starting. And that is what happened with the new restructured plan. They approached or were approached by the Inter-American Development Bank's private sector arm, the IIC, for funding. The IIC did an extensive due diligence process on both sides. Indeed, very recently, I was able to see a copy of the independent review and analysis on the initial rate of return for Four Seasons that was done. I was also able to see that which was done by the Four Seasons people themselves. And they have all come to the conclusion that the project is imminently viable, that the hotel can work and produce not only the jobs at construction, but also can produce the jobs going forward, up to 800 jobs, but equally as well bring foreign exchange into Barbados for years coming. Now the IDB has earmarked that they are going to invite their board, and is every expectation that they will, to provide, along with Anson Merchant Bank and Four Seasons generally, $180 million of financing. Foreign financing. US, yes. $180 million US dollars. Foreign financing. So they need some additional resources to not only complete the hotel, which I think is about $220 million odd, I believe it is, I'm speaking off the top of my head, and also to continue to do other things, collateral works around the property. If you have a company that is put together to execute a project, is able to attract and contract debt in relation to an investment for a particular project, and that project collapses on the rate of a global recession and financial crisis, wouldn't you expect that that company, unless it gets a new injection of capital, be considered to be a company that is compromised?
Yes, but Mr. Sinckler, that was not the reason why it collapsed. It collapsed because the investors had a fight with the developers way before the financial crisis took hold, and these are people who are fairly immune to the financial crisis because they all have mega bucks, and they pulled out because of disagreements. That's my understanding, which might be wrong, but it's my understanding, and it was not a direct reflection of the 2008 financial crisis. In fact, this project was on the skids from well before that, probably 2005.
I think your understanding is more speculation than fact. And since you do not have that fact, therefore it is extremely dangerous to put that on the table. The project was going ahead full steam. The reason why the project collapsed is because the persons who had said that they were going to put equity into the project withdrew that equity contingent on the collapse of the global economy and the financial crisis, and therefore could not go forward. The villa owners who were investing money to have their villas built then decided, look, let us have a wait and see attitude towards them. I'll give you a classic example. You're familiar with the Beachlands project. The Beachlands project was ready to go. The financial crisis came. Those people still have resources, you know, but they are very reticent about investing that large amount of resources in building condominiums in Barbados. And therefore, they said, after saying to the local contractors, go ahead and start the project, they then called and said, put it on hold. And then they came out and said, I think we may be ready to go. And then they said, put it on hold again, until it is now practically on hold permanently. Everybody in the system withdrew, not because they didn't have money, but because they have faith in the project, but because they felt, given the uncertainty of the financial situation, that it may not have been the wisest thing for them to outlay such large stacks of expenditure in a market in which they were not sure was going to be able to recover quick enough for them to sell their property. And that is basically what has happened to the Four Seasons. Now, the fact that the company has been qualified by the auditors as a concern in relation to its funding, because it was a company put together specifically for that purpose with investors. Those investors became reticent, they withdrew their money, the project collapsed, and that is where it is at. What we're doing now, or what I understand, I shouldn't say we, because it's really not my project, but what they're doing now is that they're restructuring that entirety, where those persons who originally were shareholders in the project will become minority shareholders in the project, and new equity come in from the Inter-American Development Bank, from Anson Merchant Bank, from the government of Barbados Guarantee and otherwise, from the Four Seasons project. So you're going to have an entirely new mix of persons involved in the project to give it that type of life and that new breath of fresh air that is required for it to go forward sustainably over time. So I think that what we need to do, Patrick, is to be very careful with the common speculation. You know, we go to cocktail parties, and those who have appeared in WikiLeaks should take very careful note of what I'm saying. We go to cocktail parties, hear a lot of things on the margins of meetings and at site places and at the water fountain. go and write it or publish it or repeat it and say, I heard this, I understand this, this might be true or that might not be true, and we never really get to the bottom of that. And as the late Hitler's propaganda minister said, Gorbel, if you repeat a lie often enough, somebody will believe it. And I think it is extremely...
You're not referring to me, though, Mr.
Oh, Mr. of course not. I would
just a coincidence that in response to my question, you mentioned Goebbels, right?
No. I would never call you that, Mr. Hoyer. There are far more genuine things that I can call you. Goebbels is not nearly what I would have. But this is not in relation to you. This is specifically about a general attitude in Barbados. And the NIS thing is a classic example. You know, people rushed out and gave the impression that the government of Barbados, somebody, Prime Minister, myself, or Dr. Susan, was calling up at the NIS, pressurizing them to take on Four Seasons, or pressurizing them to take on Ammon, or pressurizing them to take on this or that or the, or the next or the third. I heard, for example, only somebody making the point that we sent these statutory entities to raid the NIS to pay salaries. And that nothing can be further from the truth.